evening. Thank you for having us here. We really appreciate that you spend this time with us to answer these questions. First of all, I would like to ask you about your career, because you have a very successful career dedicated to international relations, during which you have been the ambassador of Iceland in China, representative to the United Nations office and other international organizations, including the World Trade Organization. From these different but influential positions, which have you found to be the most challenging?
Well, it's difficult, you know, every posting has its own challenges that can be quite difficult to compare, because they are of a different nature. I think one of the most challenging was, in fact, even before I became ambassador, when I was involved in the negotiations leading to the European Economic Area in Brussels. Then I was deputy and was part of the negotiating team when the EFTA countries eventually became part of this European Economic Area that is still our most important tool in our relationship with the European Union. Another was when I was ambassador in Geneva, then we had to negotiate the departure of Austria, Finland and Sweden into the European Union, and to redefine and reorganize the EFTA cooperation. That was quite a challenging task as well. And then later on, another challenging task was when I was director of economic affairs in the ministry. That was on the home front, but I had to prepare and accompany the ratification process of the EEA agreement, which was quite controversial and quite difficult. So both on the international and also the domestic front, these are some of the challenges that could go on.
Concerning the relations between Germany and Iceland, how have the relationship between Germany and Iceland changed over the years, and in what ways is the Embassy of Iceland in Berlin promoting Icelandic culture?
The general relationship between Iceland and Germany is extremely harmonious, and there are very few problems. The only sort of joke that practically the only problem is the German opposition to Icelandic whaling. It is a very thankful task to be ambassador of Iceland and Germany, because there is an underlying goodwill and interest in Icelandic affairs here in Germany, and the Germans have a positive attitude towards Iceland. So in most ways, it has been a thankful and a grateful task to fulfill here. But we find this quite important to foster and to develop this interest by presenting on a regular basis what Iceland has to offer. And because you mentioned culture, we find that it is a very important part of the image building of Iceland to present the vibrant cultural scene in Iceland, because this is part of what makes Iceland interesting, and this also builds up confidence in Iceland as a partner in other areas. Because a creative, vibrant society that has a lot to offer in the cultural field is also a society that is an interesting partner in business, an interesting partner in politics. So in a way, you can present your country through culture, but it has an effect on the political side, on the political image, on the image as an economic partner. So we find culture quite an important tool in presenting. And the good thing here in Germany is that we have unparalleled infrastructure. We have an auditorium, we have an exhibition space, we have more possibilities to do and organize cultural events here in Germany than we have in other Icelandic embassies around the world.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Now we move forward to the next question, and it's with regards to cultural diplomacy as a tool to achieve conflict resolution and peace.
Yeah.
Can you give us an example of a time during which you were involved in a successful cultural dialogue
Maybe one of the most extensive cultural projects that we have ever had abroad was the Icelanders guest of honor at the Frankfurt Bookmesse, which is the book fair in 2011. Because this was at the time, you know, the crisis hit Iceland quite hard in 2008. And we also had some difficulties in that Icelandic banks had also here in Germany overextended themselves, and there were questions about credibility of building up trust again. I think our participation in the book fair was quite an important factor in re-establishing our reputation, so to speak, on the German front, because it was an extremely well, it was an extremely successful exercise in cultural diplomacy. And the interesting thing too was that this was at a time when state finances were tough, and practically everything in Icelandic administration was cut down. Mm-hmm. But this was one of the few projects where we maintained to keep to our plans, to our budget a bit, because we thought this was such an important area in our public diplomacy.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. And Iceland applied to be part of the European Union in 2009, yeah. But in the year 2013, the government of Iceland suspended its application. In your personal opinion, what are the main reasons for the government to withdraw the application, and how do you think this decision serves the interests of your country?
I think it is one of the most controversial issues in Icelandic politics, but in a way the difficulty was that the government that came to office in 2009 and had it on its agenda to be a candidate and apply for membership of the European Union. Inside that government, there was not full agreement on that goal, because the Social Democrats were in favor, but the left Greens were skeptical, and in a way they only did it because they wanted to be part of the government, and they agreed reluctantly to send in the application, but reserved the right to be against it if they... So inside the government there was not full agreement on the goal. The opposition parties that then came to power in 2013, in the end, were basically Euro-skeptics, so to speak, saying that their attitude was that with the European Economic Area Agreement, we had fulfilled our main economic goals, and the ambition to be part of political union of the was for them not that important. There were two factors and two maybe lobbies in Iceland, in the Icelandic economic area. First, the fisheries, because the fisheries industry that is in Iceland quite an important industry, and was for a long time maybe the basis of our economy. They were skeptical because they did not believe that we would get a satisfactory deal on how to deal with the fishing resources around Iceland. And then unfortunately we never really negotiated anything, we never got around to that part, so we still really don't know what sort of a deal we might have got.
Mm-hmm.
But the opinion was quite strong within the fishing industry that this would not be possible. And the other important lobby was the agricultural lobby. It's one of the consequences of full membership of the European Union, that a sort of big non-negotiable would have been full free trade in agricultural mm-hmm. product. And the Icelandic agricultural is sensitive and in many ways.
Do you think the economic crisis that you guys had maybe was a reason for you to decide that for Iceland to decide that it wanted to withdraw the application?
In a way, it was rather the opposite, because the financial crisis more or less brought us towards applying, because people were interested in the crisis in 2008, the application comes after the election in 2009.
Mm-hmm.
And then people were anxious to seek stability, and in fact the euro at that time seemed like a safe haven to, to increase stability and open for the Icelandic economy.
Mm-hmm.
This then turned out to be quite difficult. Both the euro became maybe not quite as stable as we had, expected, and then the Icelandic economy it turned out to be quite beneficial or a practical part of the recovery to this possibility to devalue the currency.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so people in a way began to see the krona, the Icelandic currency, not only as a problem but also as part of a solution or as something that might have helped us out of the crisis rather than as a problem in itself.
And do you think the crisis is gone now, almost gone?
We are almost there. We are we've been able to now lift. We're on our way to lift the currency restrictions that were there. But the ongoing problem is still how to be an active part of an international economy with such a small currency. That is something that we still have to work on to find a proper solution. But on the whole, it's still because we have had fishing industry is thriving, the energy, in spite of lower energy prices, but still the energy intensive industry has also been doing quite well. And not least, tourism has been booming. It's we have on a yearly 20-30% increase per year in the number of tourists coming to Iceland, and this has been a great boom and a great asset to the Icelandic economy in the last few years.
Perfect. And now I would like to ask you about the demonstrations that are taking place in front of the Reykjavik Parliament, asking for the Prime Minister's resignation. What are your thoughts about the Prime Minister's situation now, particularly in the so-called case of the Panama Papers? Can you please give me your thoughts about this?
Well, basically, the protests are, of course, food for thought or something that should worry any politician when you have in a small society such as Iceland, around 20,000 people protesting in part of parliament, obviously any politician has to take this very, very seriously indeed. But he still has a majority in parliament, and the real cause for worry is when his own majority begins to voice doubts. There are some signs that this might be happening. And this is, but I'm still really waiting now for the situation might become clearer later this week or even tonight. But as for the Panama Papers, I think the Prime Minister has himself said that his performance in an interview that has now been published all over the world was he had always used the word lamentable, so he had said that he had not been prepared for these questions. But he has over and over emphasized that vis-a-vis the Icelandic tax authorities, he had no secret. He had informed the Icelandic tax authorities knew about his assets abroad, so he was not hiding anything from the Icelandic tax authorities. But of course, he had not told the public about this, and that is, of course, for a politician, always a problem not to have been transparent and open. And the question: this was the inheritance of his wife that had been then put in safekeeping, so to speak, abroad. It's not illegal. It's not, it's not tax evasion. But it's maybe not quite as transparent as one would wish for from a prominent politician.
Will he remain in his charge even though many people are asking him to resignate?
I think there again it depends on, first of all, as far as I can tell, then his own party is solid in support, but the coalition partner has not been so far giving unequivocal declarations of support. So they are saying, okay, we have to look into this, and this is what we are waiting for right now, what will come out of this process.
Okay, perfect. Thank you for this explanation. And now I want to move towards a different question concerning like the whale hunting, because like some international organizations such as Greenpeace are protesting against this whale hunting tradition that the other countries like Japan as well have. So what do you think about the international pressure on Iceland about this, like about the whale hunting?
I think it's a difficult situation in that we feel that we have the science on our side, that these stocks that we hunt, the minke whales and the fin whales, are not in danger, and that we have the right to exploit this as a natural resource. But we know also that for the general public and for the worldwide, the public opinion, then the whales are not a species like any other. They have a special mystique. You sometimes talk about charismatic mega fauna. They have a special status in the public, in the imagination of people worldwide. So it's not enough to have the science on your side or to have the legal right to do so. And what has been happening lately is that the fin whales that have been hunted by a company called Falur, however, that company has always given up, but has publicly declared that they will not be hunting any fin whales. And the reason is not that they don't think they should, but basically they have found out that the main market for these products in Japan is no longer there. So the Japanese authorities have been relatively restricted in issuing some import licenses, and some bureaucratic sort of procedures have been quite heavy and slow, which means that it's simply no longer worth it. It's no longer a proposition. And the other species that is being hunted, minke whales, is on a much more small scale. There are 30,000 more minke whales around Iceland and only a few have been hunted. But this is something that that is will be under the consideration, but the general opinion, minke whales are not quite as, the fin whales are a more difficult proposition for in the international context and in the international debate. A good friend and a prominent Spanish diplomat, Ramón de Miguel, who was a state secretary and a prominent Spanish diplomat, he once said to me that when Spain gave up whaling, he was not convinced that this was the right thing to do, but he said it was inevitable, because even Spain could not resist the pressure of public opinion worldwide, and that it was, they could not go alone. And well, Iceland is a lot smaller than Spain. We'll see how we'll do in the future, but we all realize how strong the public, the international pressure is. And this was something that would also have been quite an important issue if we had continued with our negotiations on membership of the European Union. Mm-hmm. And I personally think that in that context we might have had to give up the possibility to continue whaling, because I don't think the European Parliament would have
would have let a country in that to continue really.
Mm-hmm. And now to end up with this interview, I just want to ask your opinion about the future career chances for youth in Iceland. Mm-hmm. And what advice would you give to young people who are interested in pursuing a career in international relations or diplomacy?
I think the advice would be to what I see that young people are doing already is to be open to travel, to learn languages, to prepare themselves to be flexible in most ways, because I think flexibility and patience are very important qualities for, well, basically for anyone, but not if you want to go for a career in an international context, then you need to have these qualities above all, and have the also maybe the capacity to adapt to new circumstances and try to understand to your partner, whoever that wherever you are in. Maybe one of the challenges I had when I was in China, when you realize when you come into a different and another cultural context, then it's a challenge, but it's also in a way very enjoyable and you feel that you grow when you are confronted with a completely new cultural context, and you have to adapt and you have to learn about it. This is I think one of the many wonderful things about exercising this profession or being part of this profession.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Now I would like to ask you if you would like to add something to this interview.
Well, I think we've covered a lot of ground, and just on a few minutes, but basically international affairs and As I am now talking to a representative of the Institute for Cultural Diplomacy, the culture is a key element in both in defending the interests and building up a profile of any country. So I don't think any diplomatic mission can afford to ignore culture. Culture is definitely one of the main pillars of our work in here in Germany, but also in other places, but absolutely.
Perfect. Thank you so much for your time.